Praise the Lord, everyone. How beautiful are you, Lord? It's your world. It's your love. How glorious. How glorious are you, Lord? It's your power. It was your cross that saved me and rescued me.
Glory, glory, I give you glory, glory.
is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is great. He's clothed in majesty. He rules in power. He reigns in victory. There's no one else who can compare with him. He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is great. He's clothed in majesty. He rules in power. He reigns in victory. There's no one else who can compare with him. He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is great. He's clothed in majesty. He rules in power. He reigns in victory. There's no one else who can compare with him. He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns.
Come on, lift your hands up. Everyone, lift your hands up and sing unto him.
Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Hallelujah. You worthy God.
Oh, come on, somebody. If you believe he's
our
an
God
awesome
is great. On, he's clothed in majesty.
Shout!
He rules in power. He reigns in victory. There's no one else who can compare with him. He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love.
One more time.
Awesome God. Our God is great. He's clothed in majesty. He rules in power. He reigns. beginning.
If you believe it, I gave you the jump for him.
There's an awesome God. He reigns from heaven with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above.
Watch this. Before we go any further, I'm just curious in this place, you know, and sometimes it's, you can't just, you know, when you come to church, amen, you know, sometimes you have to bring a sacrifice of praise. You might not feel it. Maybe you've had a day where things have not gone your direction or the way you would hope for them to go. But he's still King of Kings. He's still Lord of Lords. He still died on the cross for you and me when we were yet sinners. When we were on our way to hell, and now because of him, we're on our way to heaven. What I'm saying is, we got to get to a place where it's like, you know what? Forget about the people around you, amen. And just, we got to come to the house of the Lord with the praise already in us. I said, with the praise already in us, with a shout already in us for what he has done. For what he has done in our lives, for his grace and his mercy. His amazing grace, his mercy, amen. Praise the Lord. So I just, you know, for the next few minutes, I want to sing that one more. Let's just sing it. Let's do that one more time. And if you're not ashamed of him, and you're not ashamed of the one that saved you and washed you and cleansed you, amen. And you're thankful for what he's done in your life, amen. As we get ready to sing this one more time, just look at you and say, just give me a little bit of room, because I might accidentally bump into you. I might accidentally give you an elbow right now, not on purpose, but in love, because I'm about to give him a crazy praise. I said I'm about to give him a crazy craze, a crazy celebration, a crazy shout for what he's done in my life. So I need a little bit of room, because I'm about to shout.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. God is great, he's clothed in majesty. He rules in power, he reigns in victory. There's no one else who can compare with him. He's King of Kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is great. He's clothed in majesty. He reigns in an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is great. He's clothed in.
Now look at somebody and say the next words. Look at somebody.
He rules in power. He reigns in victory.
Now find somebody else in the next.
There's no one else who can compare with him.
Now find somebody else and decree and declare.
He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God.
One more time. Find somebody. Okay, we're going to do it one more time. We're going to do it one more time. We're going to do it one more time. Okay, that's fine. We're going to do it one more time. We're going to do it one more time. And I want you to find somebody else. And when we go through those, when we start to decree, hey, he's King of kings, he's Lord of lords, there's no one else to compare. I want you to find somebody that you have not said anything to, you have not greeted, you haven't said a word to, and decree and declare those words. Amen? Come on now. Come on now. Hallelujah.
Our God is great. He's clothed in majesty. In power, he reigns in victory. There's no one else who can compare with him.
And yes, he is.
He's King of kings and the beginning and the end. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome. He's an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is great. He's clothed in majesty. He rules in power. He reigns in victory. There's no one. He's an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
Yeah. Yes. Like I said this last weekend when my father and myself, my father, we had a chance to go to minister at with Chaplain Lee in Florence, and I was ministering to the fellas, and my dad was with me, and we just got to a place where just God was moving in a very powerful way, and people started to kind of celebrate a little bit. And I'm like, man, you need to, you know, start to thank the Lord for what he's done and for what he's doing. And there's, you know, and just God got a hold of me, and was just, you know, as far as some, because some people were just, they were being an audience instead of focusing on the Lord. And I'm like, you know what, some of you are looking at me, I go, you know, I've said this before, and it's like, and you're trying to figure out, is that real? Is he sincere? Yeah, It doesn't even matter. And I was telling the guys, I go, number one, if you got that much time to critique me, then then you can't tell me that you've been praising God, because you can't be looking up. If you're looking. Number two, it's been a long day today. But once we started to say, you know what? I start to think of what he's done in my life. See, and that's the other thing. See, some of us, I've said this before, and you got to understand, you don't know what somebody else has been through and how good God has been in their lives. And I've said this before, not just salvation, I'm talking after salvation. See, and I come to the revelation it's just right there. Every time we come in this place, I don't care if we have music or we don't have music. I don't care if we don't have a keyboard. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm still gonna shout. I'm still gonna lift up his name. I said that last week. I don't need to give him praise, because I know where I was. I don't care what anybody thinks about me, how you look at me. That's why David got all crazy in the Old Testament when he was dancing for him, because God had delivered him, and he had experienced God's grace and mercy at such a high level. He can care less about anybody else around him and what people thought of him. All he cared, he just wanted to give everything he had to the one that was merciful, the one that protected him, the one that was with him, the one that covered him. Do you hear what I'm saying? We must, and I said this, we must come to a place where we break out of this religiosity of this system of religiosity of having things a certain. We've got to come here with a shout in us. Because every one of us was on our way to hell before Jesus. That's enough. Just that alone is enough. I know it's not easy sometimes, but thank God for his grace and his mercy. And as we started to sing right now, I mean, I just started to think again how good he's been and how patient he's been with me and his mercy and his grace and the people he's brought into my life to help me and to guide me and how many times if it was man would have never, in other words, God, his patience, God's faithfulness, I just start to think of all these moments when I shouldn't even be alive right now. And I don't know about you, when I start to think about that, how can you just sit there and just? I'm saying, now you might have a shout in your heart. I get that. I'm not trying to look at. But I'm saying, just when you really, really know what God's done in your life, and you know how good He's been, really, can you just sit there, and just like, oh, it's just another service. Oh, are they going to get it to the next song? Really? Well, I don't like that one. I don't care what song's being. I'm still going to find. Even if it's not a song that I'm still going to get some. I'm going to still get a praise out from inside here. I don't need to wait for the next song. I don't need to wait for the person. Praise the Lord. I've come with a shout in me because he's been too good to me. Amen. Now look at your neighbor and say, listen, you don't know what he's done for me. you think you know. Listen, you think you know the whole story. You don't know the whole story, amen. He's been, so stop, you don't know the whole story. So stop looking at me, and maybe you need to start looking at him, amen. Praise the Lord. Don't worry about, I think you may be seated for a few minutes, just for a second. We're going to come back and worship the Lord for a few minutes here. I'm under the direction of the Spirit of the Living God to break this system of becoming religious in what we do. To get a revelation, to wake up once again of what this is all about. That this is real, that we're sinners that need a savior, and we're all We all fall short of the glory of God, and because of the cross, I mean, when you really get a hold of that, and you really, it changes your whole approach to church and becoming complacent and just another service and just another. Amen. Yeah, we understand that we go to church, that our faith gets built up, because faith comes by hearing by the word of God, and something, you know, and that's where we're going to get the word to help us during, especially if we're going through something. But you know, but above all, it's like, you know what? My desire to go to church, number one, should be, watch this. It should be number one. I just need to get to the house of the Lord to just say thank you. I need to get to his house. And the number one reason, top of my list, is to give him praise, to give him glory, to lift up his glorious name with other believers corporately together, to bless him, to bless him, to give him glory. He alone to be the focus. Amen. If there's parents here tonight, we've received some what is this, for babies then? Huggies, like their wipes and stuff. Here you will find some tips that will help you during the first 40 days home with your new baby. So there's also tips. So there's about 30 of them in the bookstore. So if you have babies, if you've had a baby, or babies, twins, amen, praise God, or you know maybe somebody, let's do this also, maybe somebody that you know in your family could benefit off, you know, with the blessing. I think these are like, what are they? They're baby wipes and things for, like, so, yeah, so there's like a whole little thing there. And so in the bookstore on the way out, please make yourselves available. Just say, you know, then I'd like to receive the package for the babies. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Who's here for the first time? Who's here for the first time? Please raise your hand. Got the Teen Challenge boys over here. God bless you. Got some hand over here. Who else? Who else? Who else? Over here. But they're not raising their hand. Why are they not raising their hand? Wait. Praise God. Amen. Anybody else? Okay, let's do it again. Everybody that's here for the first time, please raise your hands. God bless you. I see three hands going up over here. I see another brother over there. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. You guys, now, is that, I see somebody back there too. Are you standing, sitting over there though? What's that now? Okay, because I want to make sure, I want to keep that area clear. So please, it's like, what's his name? What's your name? Matt, and now where, how, your first time here? All right, Matt, well, say hi to Matt, everybody. I saw a family, I see a group over here. So you guys are all here for the first time? Over here? Now, how did you guys find out about the church? Who's going to speak on behalf of the group here? Is this like a group thing? Just you three, right. I mean, you guys have been here before. Amen. And your names?
Vanessa, Maricela, and Kat.
Okay, family, friends, how? Okay, praise God. What's that?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now, how did you guys find out about the church?
I saw you on TV.
Okay. Was it AZTV or TBN?
AZTV.
Okay, so Sunday night service. Okay. Well, God bless you. It's good to have you. Are you guys originally, are you from here? Or like Phoenix, Mesa, Tarrant? Okay. Praise God. Well, it's good to have you. We got a DVD here of one of our programs. This one was aired on Praise the Lord TBN for like an hour's worth of footage of a service, some messages, the praise and worship, the worship team, and all that good stuff. So we just want to bless you with that, okay? God bless you. And everybody else, you guys, God bless you. Welcome. It's good to have you. If you're here for the first time, if you go in the bookstore, we do have something for everybody, actually, a DVD of one of our services that we want to bless you with. from about 4 or 5 months ago. And all you got to do is just go to the bookstore, let them know that you're here for the first time. We also have a card. If you guys would take the time to fill out the card and just let us know how you find out about the church, that would be a blessing to us. And if you're looking for a church home, we'd love to have you and help you answer any questions. Don't forget also, this coming up Saturday, we have baptisms this Saturday night. So many of you, many of you have come up and said, when are you doing baptism? Well, it's this Saturday, amen. So if you've recently given your hearts to Jesus, that is the night to be, to make yourselves available. Bring a change of clothes and a towel. Bring a towel, amen. And invite your families. God uses us in a very powerful way where some of your family members that maybe were not coming to church because you're getting baptized, they want to be there to just support you. And when they hear the testimonies and the word goes forth in that night, we have many that give their hearts to Jesus as a byproduct of the baptisms, okay? So it's almost like a Bible track. When you give out a track to get someone's attention, that's a your baptism. You getting baptized is almost like we're going fishing. That's the bait, amen, to get some people to come to church. And I'll tell you, we do the possible. God will do the rest. So just make sure you invite everybody. So it's this Saturday, 7 o'clock, baptisms. And don't forget, parents, Sunday, this coming up Sunday after service, we have the children's practice. They continue to practice for the Christmas Eve service, okay? I mean, that was great this past Sunday. I don't know, it was like a lot of kids. The whole thing was full here, amen? And it's not too late for any other parents that have their children ages 2 to 18. We'd love to have, to come and to join us, and it's not too late again. So plenty of time this coming up Sunday right after service, and we are serving communion this coming up service also as the first service of the month. Amen? Are you glad you're here? What I like to do is let's take a few minutes. Let's just prepare our hearts for it. What I want to do is I want to go back to a Bible study type of direction, and I've been in the book of Philippians last Tuesday we started in Philippians and on Thanksgiving, and on Sunday I continued through a couple chapters in Philippians, and I like to just kind of touch and highlight a couple more things out of the book of Philippians. And but before we do that, I like just to take a few minutes to just stand to our feet and just to open up our hearts and worship the Lord a little bit more in thanksgiving for what he has done and in preparation for the word tonight. Amen? Could we do that? Praise the Lord. Come on. Amen.
To your arms.
Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus.
To our God we lift up one voice. To our God we lift up one voice.
chains have been broken, eyes have been opened, army of dry bones is starting to rise, death is defeated, we are victorious, for you are alive. Dear God, we lift up one voice.
Thank you for your presence in this place tonight. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, Father God. In heaven, thank you for your love. Thank you. Thank you for you have a plan for us. Thank you that you loved us so much that you sent your son. You gave your son. Your only son, Jesus. That we would not perish. Jesus, we say thank you. That your life wasn't taken, but you laid it down for us. Shed your blood, your precious blood for us, that we might have life and life more abundant. And we thank you for the cross. And Holy Spirit, thank you for your presence, Comforter. Thank you. Have your way in this place tonight. Your will to be done, your name to be glorified. Touch every single heart, I pray. Every single heart, Lord. Every single heart, Lord. Let there be in this place tonight Damascus experiences. Just like Paul had on his way to Damascus, and his life was never the same. One encounter with you and his life was never the same, and he went on and finished strong for your glory. I pray this in this room right now. Damascus experiences, encounters, then not one person will be the same after tonight. We ask this, we pray this, and we give you all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. It's not the norm for me to open up, you know, sections in the Bible or chapters and books in the Bible and just kind of read and then minister off of. But I just feel the Lord directing me and guiding me just to kind of continue to do that. I actually just, on last Tuesday, I just something captured, you know, and caught my attention just to open up to Philippians. And the next thing you know, we're just kind of, God was ministering to us through his word. And pretty much we couldn't get past verse 6, amen. And return back there on Sunday. And I just feel like I'm supposed to, I want to be obedient that God still has not finished speaking to us through this book here today. I want to do a recap, just if I may, and if that's okay, somewhere in here on Sunday. So it'll be the first time you hear some of this stuff. Some we're not here on Tuesday, but the book of Philippians, chapter 1, and this is the Apostle Paul. Writing to the church in Philippi, and this church was a byproduct. This church is a byproduct of the Apostle Paul's second missionary journey that we find in Acts chapter 16. And the Apostle Paul and his ministry team went, and this church was birthed as a byproduct of the Word of God being preached and people receiving the Word of God. And now we have a church, and it's actually the first church established on the European continent. So this is the first one. So now as we open up here, we see the Apostle Paul writing to the church here that was a byproduct of second missionary journey. So we're talking about a group of people here that have been impacted by the ministry of Paul and his team. Their lives have been transformed. Some were set free, others were delivered. Many were saved from the pit of hell into the kingdom of heaven, and this church here in Philippi is very thankful to the Apostle Paul, amen, and because it was God used him to impact their lives. And I want to stop, and as I said on Sunday, because I feel like it's worth repeating, it doesn't get old. The vessel that God used and to impact and to birth this church is somebody that the Bible tells us was trying to stamp out Christianity. I mean, Paul before he was Paul, was Saul, and his purpose, his passion, he was consumed by trying to stop and stamp out Christianity. He was an enemy of the cross. He was not serving God. He was not serving Christ. He was not about the Word of God. He was about stopping Christianity once and for all. He was the one, think about it now, because this is the vessel that God is using here, that God used to birth this church. He was the vessel that God entrusted with the Holy Word of God to birth this church. But prior to this, he was the one that was giving the approval to stone Stephen. Stephen that was preaching the gospel. Stephen that was sharing the love of God. Stephen, the Bible says, full of the Spirit of God, preaching the Word of God, now finds himself in a place that the people he's trying to reach are turning against him to take his life. It is Stephen now that the Bible says looked up and saw Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father and said these words. The Bible records these words. We'd all do good to follow in his footsteps. He said, forgive them. We could just stop right there. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Jesus said on the cross, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So Stephen, following an example of his master, his savior, the one that died for him, now is following an example of Jesus, says the same thing. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. And as he's saying these things, Paul is giving the approval, and this is Saul prior to Paul, the approval to take the life of Stephen. Look at something, think about that. We're not talking about somebody that's struggling with an addiction here. I'm talking about somebody that's taking lives that are preaching the gospel. Did you hear what I just said? I'm talking about somebody here that was an enemy of the cross. I'm not talking about somebody that knows that God's up there and he knows that the Lord is good and wants to do the right thing to somebody, but you know, is struggling with some issues. But we're not talking about somebody that's going to church and trying to hinder the church and divide the church. And we're not talking about a wolf in sheep's clothing, amen? You know, we're talking about somebody that was trying to come against God himself. Lives have been destroyed because of his decisions. And here we have the Apostle Paul here writing this letter as a byproduct of being the vessel that helped birth this church. But prior to this, he was not serving God. Prior to this, he was trying to stamp out Christianity. And on his way to Damascus, the Bible tells us that he had had an encounter because he was trying to get to Damascus, because Damascus was a city that was a key city that people were coming and going to go to different directions, but it was a key city that kind of brought everything together for people to come in and go out and go in different directions. So he knew, if I can just get to Damascus, if I can get there now, once and for all, I could just put an end to this. I'm on a roll here. I'm doing good. Stephen's dead now. I mean, I'm ahead of the game right now. I'm going to stop this thing. This is not God. This is not from the Lord. I'm going to put a stop to this once and for all. But God. Look at someone and say, but God. and on his way and on his way and on his, and I believe but God happened in his life because some people in the church were praying for him. Some of us in this room, can I just say one thing? I haven't even, have we quoted a scripture yet? I can't even get into Philippians to think about this, because we're talking about the vessel that God used to write this letter here in the book of Philippians, amen. But I mean, we could just kind of settle here for a moment. I mean, but God, there was a but God because somebody in the church, somebody I believe, or somebody's plural, were praying that God would get a hold of him, and instead of Paul being an enemy of the cross, that Paul would be an asset for the cross, amen. See, sometimes we have a tendency when people come against us, or people, or things don't work out, or we think there's an enemy against us, we have a tendency, Lord, take them out, destroy them, burn them, tear them. Instead of maybe, how about this, Lord, touch their heart, Lord, deliver them, Lord, save them, Lord, restore them. Come on, somebody, amen. I believe there's some people that prayed for him and interceded for him, and because of it, he had a but God, amen. And on the way to Damascus, the Bible says that he had an encounter with Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He was knocked down, but when he got back up, he wasn't Saul anymore. He was Paul, amen. And that word, that name, Saul, is a prestigious name. It's one of a proudful name, amen. Paul means little one, amen. See, he had a name change. He went from a life of being proud and arrogant, and you hear what I'm saying, amen. And God touched him, and he had a name change, and he went. And he became a person of humbleness, a person of humility, understanding that it's all God, amen. So he had a name change. He had a name change. One encounter, one touch. Here's a guy that's trying to stamp out Christianity and now has become a weapon for God himself. And God used here, as we read the New Testament, to write 2/3 of the New Testament. And we know it's not Paul that wrote the New Testament, but it's God himself, amen. Because it's the Word of God, but God used Paul as the vessel to write 2/3 of the New Testament, and God used somebody that was a mess. The worst. So I have to repeat this from Sunday. For some of you in this room, hey, it's not the way you start. I'm going to say that again. It's not the way you start a thing. It's not the way you start a thing. It's not the way you start a thing. It's not too late. There's still time. If Paul... and God can get a hold of Paul and change his life and change his heart and then go on and use them like this to impact this many, and continually even to this day now we refer to Paul and to impact so many lives after what he did and how much of it he did prior to that. The Bible says he is not a respecter of persons. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if God can change Paul, amen, and save him and turn his life around and then raise him up and use him for his glory, amen, I'm here to tell you God wants to do the same with you, amen. It's not too late. Find 5 people and say, it's not too late. It's not too late. It's not too late. It's not too late. I'm not talking about just getting saved. I'm not talking about just going to heaven. I'm saying it's not too late to do something great on this earth for his glory. Amen. It's not too late. It's not too late for your greatest chapter to be written on this earth for his glory. Your greatest chapter is yet to be written. It is not too late. I'm not talking about just getting to heaven. I'm talking to some people in this room that have blown it over and over and over. And God has sent me here tonight to tell you it's not too late. If God can do what he did with Paul, God can do it with you, amen? It's a heart thing. Man looks at the outward appearance. God looks at the heart. So, this is who God is using in the book of Philippians, and is speaking to us today. Paul, writing a letter to the Philippians, it's a church that's a byproduct of his ministry that God has entrusted in him. And this is a guy that was trying to stamp out Christianity. If that doesn't encourage somebody, I don't know. And I'm just going to do a quick review, and I'm just going to get to a couple of things I'm trying to get to, and I'm done. He opens up by saying, Paul, Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you in all my prayers for all you, for all of you. I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it out to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. So watch this. So he starts to thank you. Remember what I said this last time. Quick recap. He starts off by saying, I thank my God every time I remember you. Remember. What did he do? He purposely was remembering what they did for him and was thankful for them because they impacted his life, because they understood that it was Apostle Paul and the ministry team that impacted their lives and they're where they're at today, and the church is operating how it's operating today as a byproduct of his commitment, his sacrifice, his willingness to go to visit them and to go and to share the gospel. Amen. And as a byproduct of this, he's thanking them every time because they in turn provided for him and helped him, not just in prayer but also provisionally with finances and many other things. Amen. So he was touched. It touched his heart. And what he was saying is, you know what? Every time I remember you, you're one of the few, and I'm okay with even the others that have been impacted with the gospel, because the important thing is that people have been impacted, but you're one of the few, is what he was saying, because this was one of the few churches that actually, after they got blessed, turned around and blessed the person that got sent to bless them. So what he was saying, I think every time I remember you, I thank God for you, because you guys have encouraged me, you've blessed me, you by giving, you're saying to me that you're trusting what God has called me to do, and it shows that you're thankful for what God has done in your lives, and my work, my labor is not in vain, and it gives me hope as I'm locked up and chained up. It builds up my faith every time I think of you and remember you and your goodness and your provision and your help and your giving and your support. It stirs me up. It encourages me, and I thank God. Don't forget. Number one, we said, don't forget to thank the ones and to go back and thank the ones that helped you get to where you're at. You got to be on purpose. I need to be on purpose. We need to be on purpose and remember continually, not once a year, and not just on Thanksgiving weekends and Thanksgiving. And even on that, at least we'd do good if we just even remembered on Thanksgiving, because some of us don't even do that with our bad selves that are praising God and thanking the Lord, and we're saying, oh, Jesus this and Jesus that, and you haven't yet, and not taking it, but we're so self-focused and self-centered instead of Christ-centered, amen? We're so caught up with ourselves, amen? Yes, we are. Don't look at me like that, amen? We have a tendency to forget the ones that helped us. There's mothers, there's fathers, there's grandmothers, there's friends, there's workers, there's pastors in our lives in the past, ministers that took the time to, some opened up. I'm going to say it like this. I know I keep on going back to this, but God has me stuck here, amen, because we need to be thankful for the ones that God has sent into our lives, because many of us in this room wouldn't be where we're at if it wasn't for a grandmother, if it wasn't for that person that opened up the house and took us in for a week or for a month or for a couple months to catch our breath, gave us a bed, a place to sleep, and some food. If it wasn't for some that helped provide a little bit so we could put food on our table for our children. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We need to never forget those that were a blessing to us in the past. For some of us from 5 years ago and 10 years ago. What was 10 years ago? What does that mean? Praise God. 10 years ago? Praise the Lord. It's still, what? So we still can't pick up a phone and say thank you? How about getting a card for some of, there's some that, how about getting a card and tucking in a little gift and saying, you know what, I remember 10 years ago, and I'll never forget, and this is, again, I know you know my heart, and this, but I want to show you how thankful I am, and this is just something that's on my heart, and bless some people. See, everyone's looking at me again. Sounds like Jesus to me. I said it sounds like Jesus to me. Some of you, well, I mean, I'm struggling right now. Well, it doesn't. You don't have to put like $1,000 in there. How about $20? That means don't go to the movie that weekend. If you're really thankful and you are really sincere and you know and you're thankful for what they've meant in your life, amen. And you are and you understand that and know that and you're really saying, you know what, this is what it's all about. This is I wouldn't be where I'm at right now. Then you know what, you would make time and watch whatever is important to you. You'll make time for it, amen. Whatever your focus is will become your destination. If you really want to be a blessing to somebody, you can do it. And you can get creative. So stop talking like, well, it's just a little different. There's never a good time. I'm going to wait until everything lines up, the stars line up, the moon is where it needs to be, the temperature needs to be 78 degrees, praise the Lord. Give me a break. Look at someone say, give me a break. Good people that have been blessing to us, family members, friends, workers. Some of us, some workers have poured into our lives and we're where we're at today. Email, text them, do something. Don't ever forget. And by doing so, you're also encouraging them. And by doing so, you're encouraging them so they can get, because you never know when they're ready to give up. And sometimes God will use you to impact them at a time when they maybe they're feeling like they're not being like their life hasn't really amounted to much and they really haven't made a difference. And then all of a sudden 5 years later, 10 years later, you know, they get a car, they get a phone call, and you let them know what they've meant into your life and how you're serving God now and you're moving forward for the glory of God. And if it wasn't for them, that you wouldn't be where you're at today. I'll tell you, that'll mess them up, that'll encourage them, that'll give them hope if they want to give up. And I shared this on Sunday a while ago, it was a long time ago, when God had me stop when I was driving, I was on my way out of the city, long story short, to call somebody. And this was before the cell phones and all that stuff. I didn't have a cell phone back then. And I stopped and I got in a payphone, made a phone call to thank somebody from when I first got saved. And this is like 3-4 years later after I was saved. And God used me and just really stirred me on, you know, just reminded me, you know what this person and some of the things they shared and the time they took to pour into my life. And I stopped and I went in the payphone. I called. They were there. They picked up the phone. And all of a sudden, I hadn't really been in much contact with this person. I mean, I was still talking, but not that much. I hadn't talked to them in a while. And I didn't know, but they were kind of, to some degree, I kind of knew, but I didn't know for sure. But they were kind of away from the things of God. And I called, and I just want to just tell you, this is all I wanted to say was, thank you for what you have meant in my life, because I can tell you right now, it's 3-4 years later, I wouldn't be where I'm at right now. You know, there's many people that have poured in the last couple years into my life, but you are one of them, and if it wasn't for you, I know I wouldn't be where I'm at right now. God used you to stir up. God used you to fuel my fire. God used you to push me so I can get boldness. God used you in such a profound way, and I want to let you know, and I want to tell you thank you. And that person was ready to give up and run completely away from the things of God, didn't want to have any, he was just at the end of the end. And that phone call turned things around, gave him the hope that he needed, and got back up and moved forward for the glory of God. Amen? And we can't wait for messages like this all the time to do that. We've got to put on our mirror, like I said. I won't come back. This is the last time I come to this. Amen? Well, unless Jesus tells me to come back on Saturday or Sunday again. Amen. Praise God. I shouldn't say that either. Amen? But you know what? You got to be on purpose. So when you wake up in the morning, if it takes, you know, because we are people, if it takes your mirror and getting your marker out or your lipstick out or your whatever you got to do and put on the mirror, remember. And make a list. If that's what it takes, every once in a while to say thank you from all the people in the past that have been a blessing in your life. And I'm not talking about doing it once every year. 4 or 5, every so often, a phone call, a card, a note. God bless you. I haven't forgotten what you've done in my life. Praying God, I'm praying for you. I'm praying blessings. I'm praying. There's so many different ways to continue to encourage that person. Don't forget. That's what Paul was doing here. Look at somebody and say, don't forget the ones that have helped you get to where you're at. Yeah. Yeah. Don't forget. Don't forget. Don't be like that.
when you do that, you feel good. You're not just encouraging them, but then you start to feel pretty good about yourself. You start to get encouraged because you know what their response and what it did to them. And now all of a sudden your faith has increased. Your faith has been stirred up. Your faith now has increased for the glory of God. And when you do so and you're thanking somebody, as I said on Sunday, I know I was doing a recap and now I can't move on. Amen. Listen, when you thank somebody and you're focused, you're remembering what they did in your life. And it's a God moment. It's a God altar, which means now your focus is on the things of God. Amen. So now watch this. Your faith is being stirred up because you're remembering how God showed up in your life back then. Just like David. How did David encourage himself in the Lord? When David, the Bible says, encouraged himself in the Lord. I believe he started to remember how God showed up with a lion, and God showed up with a bear, and God showed up and was faithful with them with Goliath. And when he started to think back that God was faithful every single time, and God was faithful to show up and was with him, that his faith was encouraged and it increased. And then he asked the Lord, should I go? Because everything had been taken from him. And the Bible says that God says, go and recover all. Amen. And he went forth with confidence after he was at the end of the inn where his own men were about to kill him. And everything was turned when David encouraged himself in the Lord. You know how you can encourage yourself in the Lord? When you start thinking back of how people have been a blessing in your life. Because when you think back of how people impacted your life, you start to remember those were God moments. Because it was God that sent them to help you. And God showed himself through them. It was them, but it was God working through them. It was God himself that picked you up. It was God himself that blessed you when you needed that financial help to meet a bill or to get food on your table. It was God himself working through them. And every time you start to think and remember the ones that God sent, your faith is stirred up and you remember that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And if God did it back then, he'll do it again. Look at someone and say, don't ever forget, don't ever forget, don't ever forget. Being confident, verse 6 of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it out into completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Being confident of this. Being confident of this. So it's great. I love this because before Paul really starts to minister to the people, he first gives thanks and remembers what they've done. Always. So number one, don't forget. Don't forget the ones that have impacted your life. Don't forget. There's people, I feel in the Spirit of God. There's people from 5 years ago. There's people from 10 years ago. There's people that are in this room right now from 15 years ago that impacted your life that you need to pick up the phone. I'm telling you right now, under the anointing of God, there are people in this room that need to pick up the telephone, do something to get into contact with some people that impacted your lives 15 years ago. I get this number right now, 15. And someone said, well, Pastor, I think it's more 16. Whatever, amen. But I know I'm seeing 15 in my spirit right now that were relevant in your life that you have not had communication, that you have not talked to, and many years have gone by. And those people impacted your life when you needed the help the most, amen. And you have not talked to them. You have not gone out of your way to at least to make contact or even an email or something. And some of you in this room might not know where they're at, but if you really want to get a hold of them, you can find out where they're at. And by the way, I'm not giving you a sermon right now. This is thus saith the Lord right now, by the way. Look at something. You need to pick up the phone. And for some in this room, your breakthrough for what you're going through right now, your phone call is your breakthrough. Because he who refreshes others, I'm under, I'm a,
He who refreshes others will be refreshed himself. That person right now, that phone call right now, is not going to work just one way. It's going to work both ways. Don't forget number one. Number two, verse 6, he goes on to say, now be confident. Being confident in this, he began to work in you, will carry it out. So I want to encourage you in this place. What God has started, he's going to bring to completion. We're not talking about man. We're talking about God. When God's hand is involved in a life, we're not talking about somebody that comes up short. We're not talking about somebody that fails. There is no failure in God. There's no, he doesn't come up short. When his hand, and he is the main contractor of building your house, it's going to last. It's going to fit. In other words, let me just say it like this quickly, and I'd just like to sit here for a while too. The facts will not have the final say. According to this promise in verse 6, and be encouraged in this room right now. Look at something, be encouraged, just like this. Tell them like this, right? Be encouraged. Be encouraged right now. Be encouraged right now. Be encouraged. Watch this. We're talking God. That's why Paul says to the Philippians, be confident in this, because watch this. God is the one that has started this, and God is not a person like man that starts something and then gives up on it, starts something and does five other things, and the rest is incomplete. When God starts something, he finishes. Amen. I said, when God starts something, he completes it for his glory. You're a masterpiece that God is working on. And as long as you don't give up and give in, he's going to complete that masterpiece. Look at how I say, he's speaking to you. You might have not started as a masterpiece, but you might have started as a mess. But I'm here to tell you, if God's involved now, he's going to watch this. He's going to complete what he started, and you're going to go from being a mess to a masterpiece. Shout, that's me! That's a promise of God. That's the word of God. So he transitions from saying thank you and remembering to say, now watch this now. Now you be encouraged. Now he's trying to encourage the church here at Philippi. But God's encouraging us right now. And he says, listen, see, because this is not man. Man comes up short. Man will give up. Man will start other things. But when God puts his hand in something, he finishes it. Because he's God. I said he's God. So we could say like this, number two. The facts are not going to have the final say according to this promise. The circumstances are not going to have the final say according to this promise in verse 6. The devil, the enemy, will not have the final say in your lives according to the promise in verse 6 of chapter 1. But we can confidently move forward and say that Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, is going to have the final say in your lives, in your families, for his glory. Shall I believe it? Number one, don't forget. Number two, he's going to complete it. Number three, quickly, chapter one. I'm still recapping. Oh, Jesus. Verse 15 goes on to say, it is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so in love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely supposing that they could stir up trouble for me while I'm in chains. But what does it matter? I love that. What does it matter? I don't care. The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, look at these words. Look at what he says. And because of this, I will continue to what? Number three, God's saying to us here, stop looking to the left, stop looking to the right. Let me say it like this. God hasn't called you and me to be Holy Ghost juniors, to critique every church, every denomination, everybody, you know, you hear what I'm saying? The way you change, something that you want changed around you, when something's not right, when something's crooked and it needs to be straightened out, watch this. If God gets a hold of your heart and you do it the way you're supposed to do it, God first starts with us, you, me, one, but individually. See, we have a tendency to try to fix everybody else around us. And the person that needs the most fixing is us. And the reason why everybody around us is a mess has got nothing. Listen, we're actually being a hindrance sometimes too to the gospel going forward, because we're trying to be policemen in the spirit of God, trying to like fix this person and correct this person. And why don't they preach? And why don't they talk more on this? And why don't they speak on this? And why doesn't he teach on this? And why does he always say like this? And why does he always sweat? And why does he always run? And why do they? And why? And why? And why? Maybe if you stop saying why and drop to your knees and say, Lord, help me, maybe you can come out of that mess. I said, maybe if you say, Lord, help me, instead of trying to. That's what Paul's saying. Listen, I got enough to deal with. I got enough to deal with here. Myself, the ministry, what I'm responsible for. And I understand, because he's addressing the church here, because obviously for him to be saying it, some of the people in the church were having issues with this. They were saying, look, what about this? And you know, what about? And someone said, Paul, what about? Paul, but did you hear what they, and what there's? And Paul's like, who cares as long as Jesus is being lifted up? Who cares as long as Jesus is being lifted up? And at the end, they're going to have to answer to him. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to keep on moving forward. And the way we change something that we want changed in a church, within a neighborhood, within an area, we let God change us. And then, not even with the words we speak as much as our actions and the way we live changes the people around us. And then we can say, like Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. And it's not even the words, because a lot of us are saying, follow me as I'm following. They're like, I ain't going to follow you. Look, follow you where? Right into the liquor store, right over here? I mean, what are you talking about? Oh, come on now. But the good gospel news is, it's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. Just get it right, amen? See, some of us are trying to change everybody around us, but God's saying, you need the change first. And then you don't even have to say, follow me. Your walk, your mouth, your speech, your works will speak for themselves, and you'll be like a light. You'll be like a fire where people will want to, they're going to be attracted to you, you know, because they're going to say, what's going on here? Because when there's someone's on fire, people come to see that thing burn, amen? Or when something's lit up, what's that thing where, you know, the light, and the light, with the bugs, and there's a light, and then but we're not going to zap them. They're not going to get zapped when they come to you, amen? But, you know, when they get attracted to that, what is that thing? That's it? Bug zapper? Isn't there like a more elaborate name? Like, it's that light electrical zapper. Well, they are going to be zapped by the Holy Spirit. Are you hearing what I'm saying here? The most critical people are not in the world, it's in the church. Always trying to fix everybody. Instead of just being an example, letting God do the work in us, loving people, and then being an example. John Wesley said when God was using him back in the day for a great move of God back in the day, where thousands upon thousands, this great man of God was used to bring many into the kingdom of God. They asked him, what is the secret? What have you done to have this great move of God? And he said, it's very simple. He goes, it's not complicated. I get alone with God. God sets me on fire, and then I go out, and people come and see me burn.
So number three, look at somebody and say, don't look to the left, don't look to the right, look unto him, the author, finisher of your faith. Amen. Chapter 2, real quick. So that was number 3. This is where I left off on Sunday. Verse 14. I have to. Look at them, say, he has to. We're just having a Bible study, amen? Isn't this fun? It's fun. Look at them, it's fun. Verse 14. Do everything without complaining or arguing. Do everything without. Everything means what? What? Yeah. That means everything. Everything you do until you go to be with the Lord or until he comes. That means everything. That means all the time, not some of the time. Not, watch this, do everything without complaining. Watch this, complaining and arguing or complaining and murmuring. Watch this, it doesn't say do everything and don't complain and murmur. You could for 6 days, but on the seventh day, you have 1 hour to do so. It didn't say that. It doesn't say that. It says do everything without complaining and arguing, which it doesn't say, 7 days, but I'll give you 5 minutes every week just to let loose a little bit. Amen. Just get it out of your system. It doesn't say every other day. It doesn't say every day. Don't complain and murmur, but out of 24 hours in the day. Is that what it says? Maybe it says it in verse 13. Hold on a second. Yeah. Oh, there it is. Yeah, it does say in verse 13, since there's 24 hours in the day and there's 7 days, each day, 24 hours, God says to the church that each day you can have 45 minutes out of the 24 hours and you can complain and you can argue once a day, 45 minutes per day, and it's okay. Is that what it says in verse 13? Do everything without complaining or arguing so that you may become blameless and pure children of God, without fault in a crooked and depraved generation in which you shine like stars in the universe. And what he's saying is, when you don't complain and you don't murmur, you're following in my footsteps, and you shine and you're bright and you become attractive. And let me hear, this is real. This is in the Bible. We need to start reading the Bible, and by the grace and the help of the Lord, we need to start doing what the Bible says and stop playing games with God. Amen. And think that it's okay and it's no big deal. God says don't complain and don't murmur, amen, because it does not please him. We can't tell the difference today between the world and the church. The church complains and murmurs and argues with one another more than the world does. That's the truth. Don't look at me like I'm crazy. That's the truth. Something's wrong when there's more arguing. There's more division, more unforgiveness, more complaining, more divisions in the church, when the church should be one, when the church should be submitting to one another, when the church should be turning the other cheek, when the church should be loving one another and building one another up. And go to Ephesians real quick. Can I get, are we okay? Sorry, we're just Ephesians chapter 4 real quick. Look at, I think it's perfect right here. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 25. Let's connect this. Therefore each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor. For we are all members of one body. Speak truthfully. There's a lot of lying going on in the church. And some of the greatest liars of a holy God. I'm not trying to condemn. I'm not trying. This isn't. But you know what? Let's get it right. Let's get the fear of God. I'm telling you, there's a holy fear that has gotten a hold of me the last month or so. And I'm looking at my life. I'm looking at my heart. I'm looking at the way, just everything. Things that, you know, just kind of like, and I'm thinking, wow. I'm starting to pick up the Bible, and I'm like, really? You know, when you really read, and it's not about just preaching. I mean, I'm just talking about, Lord, cleanse me, Lord. Renew my mind. Lord, speak to me, Lord. And I mean, every word the last month seems to be jumping out and grabbing me and hitting me over the head. We're just having Bible study. Watch this. Speak truthfully to his neighbor. For we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer. Look at somebody, stop it. Yeah, you know, we're laughing, but you know what? I mean, it's kind of sad, but you know, people, we're taking the offering and people steal from the offering. You know that in here, amen? It's kind of sad, isn't it? I mean, no fear of God that you're going to get, if you're in here right now, because you might be in here right now, you know you're going to give an account to the one that created you. You stole from God. You didn't steal from me. You didn't steal from this church. You stole from God. You stole from God. Are you crazy? Aren't you scared? Don't you have any fear? If you're going to do something, do it outside the church, and I'm saying it's okay. But you're going to come to church and do it? Are you crazy? You better get it right. You better repent. And then, as soon as you get that money, come back and bring it back and double it and triple it and say, Lord. Get it right. Just get it right. There's mercy. This isn't the end. But get it right. Receive the word tonight. Now I know in my spirit, God is saying there's people in here that this is a word for you. And maybe not in this place, maybe somewhere. You have stolen from God. Oh my God. I know when God's speaking to me like this. You have stolen from God. Maybe it's not in the offering. Maybe it's from a child of God. You have, when you steal from them, you're stealing from God. You have stolen from God. I'm going to say that again. You have stolen from God. Here is your word. What do I do? Repent, repent, repent. Repent, repent, repent. Humble yourself, call upon his name, and receive his mercy, and get back up and do it the right way. While there's time. I said while there's time. Is there time? Yes, there's time right now to get it right. Repent, repent, repent. Because someday if you don't get that right, you don't know what then is going to come knocking at your door. and you are going to give an account. And if you haven't gotten it right and you haven't gotten under the blood of Jesus, you're going to be standing in front of God and you're going to have to give an account for that. That should, right there, that right there should scare the hell out of you. I said that right there tonight should scare the hell right out of you. Amen. Is everybody all right? You know, we don't talk about stealing in the church that much. You know what I mean? Like, you know, as far as stealing, you know, thou shalt not steal. That's for the world. But you know what? You know, Paul is addressing the Philippian church. And then Ephesians, this is the church of Ephesus. So we're not talking about the world. He's not addressing the world here. He's addressing the church. So obviously, he's saying, look at this. He goes, listen, in your anger, okay? And then he who has been stealing must steal no longer. He said, listen, some of you are still operating like the world. Are you kidding me? And what does he say? So here's the answer. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work. Look at somebody and say, get a job. Look at that. You know what? He's preaching really good. Look at somebody and say, he's preaching really good and teaching really good.
This is good.
Find five people and say, get a job, get a job, get a job, get a job. Yeah, yeah. With your bad, lazy self. Amen. That's what it is. Lazy, lazy, lazy. Amen. Well, there's no jobs. No, if you're willing, we just had three classes on how to help you get a job. And for some of you that don't have a job and are looking for a job and are saying, oh, I just can't find a job, if you didn't show up on those three Monday nights to help you get a resume, to help you find jobs, which God was giving you an opportunity and you had that opportunity, you know what that's called? Lazy, 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 lazy. And nowhere in the Bible does God say in the scriptures anywhere that God blesses lazy. You didn't hear me. You will not find in the Holy Scriptures, the holy living Word of God, anywhere from beginning to end, from Genesis to Revelation, nowhere in the Holy Scriptures will you see the word lazy and God's blessing on it. You will not see lazy and God's favor. You will not see God the word lazy and God's increase. You will not see lazy and God opening up a door. Nowhere in the Bible will you find lazy and blessing together. What you will find is, you're lazy, don't expect to eat. There might be some people here for the first time going, oh my, what is going on here? What is going on here? Pastor, man, come on. Have you just finished Thanksgiving? It's Christmas time. Easy. Okay. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. We should be getting to a place eventually, and I know it's getting, but I got to add one thing and we're done. Seriously, this is, you know, we're joking, but I'm being serious right now. Please, this is not a sermon again. I'm giving you a now word. God is speaking to us right now. We need to get to a place after we've been saved. We start to, and we might need help in the beginning, but we should be getting to a place if we do it His way, that it's not later on, 40 years later, and we're still the ones that are in need. We should, and I can confidently say this because the Word says it. If it's 40 years later and we're still, wait a second, then we're not doing something the way He told us to do. In our giving, in our commitment, in our sacrifice, in our reading, in our obedience, there's a breakdown if we're still strong, and we are the ones that are still taking instead of. He's saying eventually, if you do it my way, you work hard, you follow my instructions, obey my word, you're going to get to a place where you're not the one that's receiving all. You're the one that's looking and giving out and blessing people. Shout, that's me. I'm just trying to help us. Okay, buddy, here's what I was trying to get to this whole time. Do not let any, remember what he said? Complaining and arguing, right? Philippians. He said, what did he say? Complaining and arguing, right? In Philippians. But watch this in Ephesians. So do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful. I always say, if you don't got something good to say, don't say. And someone might say, well, Pastor, what do you mean? Where's that in the scripture?
Here it is.
Because some of you, I think, say, well, he's just saying some stuff. No, here it is. It's all scripture. So I'm just letting you know where he talks in Philippians, don't complain, don't murmur, don't argue. And then I went on to say on Sunday, and if you don't got something that's going to build somebody up, if it's not going to be the solution, if it's not going to be helpful, if it's not going to be useful, zip it up, zip it up, zip it up, zip it up, and don't say nothing, amen? Because the Bible says in Proverbs 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue. If you don't got something good to say, watch this. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed from the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Be watch this. Look at someone, say, watch this. Be kind and compassionate to one another. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other. But you don't know what they did. You don't know what they said. Be kind and compassionate. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other. Is that on there or no? Do you guys get that or not? The next scripture, the next verse, if you can. Be kind and compassionate to one another. It doesn't say be kind and compassionate only when it falls under these categories. If they, you know, they did right, or if, you know, if they did. In other words, there's no. Only when you're right or they're right or you're wrong and they're right, whatever. It doesn't. Just be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other. And this is the, this is it. Just as in Christ God forgave you and me. Our job is to forgive. To be compassionate. To pray. You don't have to break bread with them every day. But make sure that it's not in your heart. God's working on me on some stuff right now. In some areas. I'm like, Lord, I'm just going to. God says, no, you need to go out of your way to make sure that they know, every one of them, that you're good, that you're fine. This is real. This is Bible. This is the gospel. We need more compassion in the church. And I'm not talking about the lost. I'm talking about the people around us. The other thing, let me say this. Can I say one more thing? You want to go home? You want to go home? Okay, I'm saying I don't want to keep you if you're busy and you got to go catch. I don't know. I understand it's past 8:30, but this is one of those nights right now. I'm finished. I know. I'm trying. We are so quick, also. When people in the church have moments, fall, slip up, mess up, and we're so quick to get on the phone, and instead of covering them up in prayer, in love, I'm not saying it's okay, but speaking to the lives, if God allowed you to see something or hear something, he didn't. Did you ever think that maybe he's trusting you to see it and to hear it so you can fall on your knees and pray them through to restoration? You're not ready for that. You're not ready for this. We are so quick to bring down, to destroy, to beat up, instead of being like Jesus when Peter denied him three times, building him back up. Peter, do you love me? Yes. Peter, do you love? Yeah. Peter, do you love? Then go feed my sheep. I'm not saying we're gonna, but we're saying let's work on it. When someone's willing to know when they've messed up, we should not be kicking them when they're down. When they are humble and broken and are willing to get it right, at that time, our job is to cover them in prayer, cover them in love, cover them in encouragement, to get them to a place of restoration. We are not the world trying to destroy one another. We're trying to help one another. And if it wasn't for Jesus, think about where we'd be ourselves. We're so quick sometimes when someone messes up to say, I knew they were going to fire you. And now it's like we want to tell. Instead of our hearts breaking and saying, praise God, Lord, if you're showing me this right now, maybe you're showing it because you are trusting me right now to be faithful, to not complain, not to gossip, not to murmur, but how about drop to our knees and pray? I'm looking for one thing, and can you hear me? Watch this. Are you still there? I wasn't planning on going here, but this is necessary, and we're done. Are you glad you came? We're going to jump from Ephesians now away from Philippians, and I'm not going to get to where I was trying to get to in Philippians, by the way. I'm still in the in just kind of going back and just kind of repeating some stuff from Sunday and Tuesday. I actually did not get to where I was trying to get to. I was actually trying to get to where he said in Philippians, your citizenship is in heaven. That's where I was trying to get to. I wanted to just sit there for a little while and just talk about our citizenship in heaven. But look at something, but not now. Genesis chapter 9. Genesis chapter 9, verse 18. The sons of Noah who came out of the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. These were the three sons of Noah. And from them came the people who were scattered over the earth. Noah, a man of the soul, of the soil, proceeded to plant a vineyard. When he drank some of its wine, he became drunk. In other words, Noah got drunk. Bible says don't get drunk but be filled with the Spirit of God. So he messed up. Noah, the leader, the ministry and the church, your person sitting next to you, he got drunk. He became drunk and lay uncovered inside his tent. Ham, the father of Canaan, saw his father's nakedness. And what did he do? And told his two brothers outside. But Shem and Japheth took a garment The first one went in, and the first thing he did, instead of covering his father, covering his brother, not talking about somebody that's out there and it's like, I don't care about the things of God. I'm talking about someone that's broken now, that's in the process, giving them the opportunity to get it right, to get a chance to get back up and move forward. His first action was not to cover him, but left and started to blab his mouth. Ooh, this will preach right here. But the other two took a garment. You know what the garment is? Prayer. You know what the garment is? Encouragement. You know what the garment is? Going in and saying, listen, you know, I'm sure you're aware of this, but, you know, and I'm here to help you. I'm not here to go around and start to gossip, but I'm here to help you. And it's for some of us, we can even relate depending on certain situations. And so I've been there, and I just want to let you know that, you know, whatever this is, just know that I'm praying for it. I'm here if you need me in any kind of a way. And I believe that God, and especially when there's a, I've always said that as long as there's somebody that's willing to move forward and get it right and move forward, I will never leave the side of anybody that's willing to get back up and move forward. The only problem I'll have is when someone gets done and then is like, you know, whatever, and I don't care, and it's no big deal. No, that's a problem. But when there's someone that's broken, that is not the time to go and start talking and exposing and beating up and kicking and putting down. What we need to do is they took a garment and laid it across their shoulders. Then they walked in backward. And covered their father's nakedness. Their faces were turned the other way so that they would not see their father's nakedness. The one ran out. You won't believe! I knew it! It was too good! Yeah. Jesus never kicked somebody. He always gave that person an opportunity to get back up. And watch this. And when Noah woke from his wine and found out what his youngest son had done to him, he said, cursed be Canaan. The lowest of slaves will be to his brothers. He also said, blessed be the Lord, the God. This is powerful. The God of Shem. May Canaan be the slave to Shem. May God extend the territory to Japheth. May Japheth live in the tents of Shem, and may Canaan be his slave. And Noah, and after that, the flood, Noah lived 350 years. Bottom line is, the two sons that covered him walked away with a blessing. You want to be blessed? You want favor? You want mercy in your life? Don't be somebody that's walking around gossiping and talking. When God trusts you enough, if you see something or hear something, don't be quick to immediately, you know, how about dropping it? Because maybe God is saying to you, I trust you enough with your walk with me that you've come to a place of maturity where at this point I'm trusting you, because that person or that situation that I'm showing to you, I'm trusting you to get on your knees and pray them through. And what they do later, and some of you will say, well, what happens then? Well, then that's between them and God eventually, amen. Pray them. But you know what? But let God deal with that afterwards, amen. But our job immediately at first, don't be quick to destroy somebody and beat somebody down when you're down, because you know what? A month down the road, or a year down the road, or 5 years down the road, the thing that you say, oh, I would never, you better watch yourself, amen. And you might be the one that can use somebody to cover you, but when you had the opportunity to cover somebody, you didn't do it, and guess what? You have no deposit in your bank account of mercy, because what you did was run on the phone and talk to 20 other people and run your mouth. Plop, 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 plop. Can I get a good amen? If you don't got something good to say, find five people and say, zip it, zip it, zip it, zip it, zip it. No, no. Find seven people. That's the number of completion. Zip it, zip it, zip it, zip it, zip it, zip it. Amen. That garment is prayer, it's love, it's words of encouragement. That's what that garment is in the Old Testament right there. And because they did that, they got a blessing because of it. A lifelong blessing in Jesus' name. I want to be like that. Amen. Lift up your hands and say, I receive the word of God tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord. If I can have the ushers quickly to come forward at this time. Praise the Lord. Did we take the offering? We didn't. Okay. If you need an offering envelope, please raise your hand. We'll get one out to you as quickly as possible. There should be an offering envelope in the seat pocket in front of you, though. If there's not one, though, we'll get one out to you as quickly as possible. Praise the Lord. That concludes our Bible study tonight. I want to encourage you. When you get a chance the rest of this week, go to Philippians, read it all the way through. It's easy, short reading, amen. Meditate on it. And then, if I'm correct, backtrack to Ephesians and read Ephesians. And I believe God's going to really fuel and stir up and confirm and take this night and take it to another level, amen, for the glory of God, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Look at that. I got you covered. Now, some of you, let me ask you a question. Some of you looked at some, you know, some of you just had somebody look at you and say, I got you covered. Did you really believe them? I don't know. Did some of you, it's like, you know what I'm saying? Like, sometimes I got you covered. And it's like, really? I don't know. Do I need to change seats? Okay, are you ready? And she's like, yes, I need to change seats. Amen. Watch this. Okay, are you ready? Okay, look at the person next to you and say, I've got you covered in Jesus. Yeah? Are we good? Everyone feel good about it? Or should we do one more redo? Does everyone feel good about that one? Or are you still kind of like, I don't know? Okay, one more time. Ready? Look at your neighbor and say, I got you covered. Yeah? 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 Shout yeah? Are you ready to give to the Lord? Praise the Lord. Lord, I thank you for these precious hearts, Lord God. Thank you for these soldiers that you're raising up for such a time as this. And Lord, thank you for tonight. We thank you for this night once again, for this is the day that you have made, and we are rejoicing in it. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And we say thank you this night for the opportunity to be a blessing into your kingdom, to impact your kingdom and reach more for your glory. So Lord, I pray right now as your people give tonight, Lord God, bless them, press down, shaken together, overflowing. And I pray tonight, Lord God, above, especially with offerings, Lord God, as people give, Lord God, hallelujah, tonight, Lord God, no matter how small, great, you know, you see the heart tonight, amen, and what they're able to do. This is my heart's desire here, and this is my prayer. As they have delighted in you, the desires of their heart, Lord God, and I pray as they give and plant this seed tonight for your kingdom, for souls, Lord God, as they plant tonight, I pray in the name of Jesus, 100-fold return from this seed that's being planted before the end of the year for it to come to pass for your glory. In the name of Jesus, whatever that thing is to glorify your name, I pray it, Lord God, to come to pass in the name of Jesus. And shout, I believe it. Praise the Lord. You guys go ahead and serve the people at this time. Praise God. Don't forget baptisms on Saturday night. Oh, and also, we got the women's December 14th. So it's 1 week earlier, and you guys are gonna have like tea and stuff and like tables in here but food also and service, and I guess you guys are gonna have like a thing, a ladies' thing. Amen. Ladies' tea party. And I'm hearing from the front row, just to make it clear, it's ladies only, no men. Amen. And there is baby, and there is child care. And there is, and ladies, there is child care for that night. Amen. Praise the Lord. Real quick, as we're taking and finishing off, please, just for a couple seconds. I know I've been, but do you believe that God was speaking tonight? And let me clarify something tonight to everybody here and watching at home. God's speaking to me first. I don't want to settle. You guys, I don't know about you. I don't want to settle. I want to finish right. And tonight, His grace and His mercy is here for us to get up and continue to move forward and make the adjustments that need to make. If there's an adjustment needs to be made, make it. Amen. Run into the hands of God. With Him, you can do it. Some of you might say, Pastor, I've tried too many times with this. No, you can do it in Jesus' name through His grace. His grace is here to help you. Turn to me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you. Honor me. Don't give up. Don't ever give up. Because what He has started, He will bring to completion. That's a promise. If you're in this place and say, Pastor, I've never given my heart to Jesus, you're a miracle. If you want the hands of Jesus in your life, to know that what He started, He's going to bring to completion, something's got to start. And the way it starts is by you inviting Him into your heart. You have that opportunity in this place right now. If that's you on the count of three and say, Pastor, that's me. I want to get right with God. I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. Remember, there's not 20 ways to heaven. There's only one way to heaven. Only one that died on the cross and rose from the grave on the third day. His name is Jesus. Amen. And He loves you. He is not intimidated with your sins. He died for every one of your sins. And it's not too late. It's not the way you start. It's the way you finish. Your miracle, your turnaround starts with a relationship with Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the Bible says, those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. His hands of grace and His hands of mercy are here tonight. Not condemnation. He's not angry with you. He's not upset. He loves you, and you have an opportunity to run into the loving arms of God and to get back up and move forward and become the champion that God's called you to be. That is the gospel. That is the word of God, and He is here tonight to help you. If that's you on the count of three and say, Pastor, that's me. Pray for me. I want to get right with God. I want to receive Him as Lord and Savior of my life. I want to finish strong for Him. I don't want to live the way I'm living. I don't want to live for the enemy. I don't want to live in the world anymore. I want to live for God. Amen. And I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. If that's you on the count of three, one, two, three, lift up your hand and say, that's me. Pray for me. Is there anybody right now? Quickly. Yes, thank you. I see a hand. Yes, I see a hand. Yes, I see that hand. I see two hands, three, four, five, going up all over. Anybody else over here? I see all those hands over here. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And you know what? For some of us, wouldn't it be worth it that we went 15, 20 minutes or longer than maybe for these tonight, maybe even for one of them tonight needed to hear the last 20 minutes? Maybe it was, and I know I think it's for all of us, but I mean, if it was just for that one over here that's about to get saved, would it not be worth it for us to just kind of rearrange a little bit of our schedule to see a soul come into the kingdom of heaven? Is that not what it's all about? Is this not what we're all involved in before it's all said and done? Every hand that went up quickly. Every hand that went up, stand on your feet quickly, quickly, quickly. Every hand, any hand. There's that young man. Thank you. I see all these young people. Praise God. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Woo! Look at this, look at this, look at this. It's like a whole family back there. Amen. Praise the whole row. That's awesome. You guys, it's awesome. Come on. I want all, everybody standing in their feet, you guys, quickly, just step on, come over here, come over here. I'm going to pray for you right now. Come on, quickly, quickly. Come on, everyone standing in your feet, come. This is awesome. Oh, come on, I'll encourage them. Awesome. Well, really, you guys see, that's why you can't rush this. Can I, is this in your name?
Garrett.
Okay, no, we got some team challenge. They came with a group tonight. Now, watch this. Now, so, this, so he just started the program. Now, a lot of the guys, sometimes when they start the program, They're not saved. They're just trying to get some things right. It's an opportunity to get back on their feet. And some, and I've heard many times, like, well, I just wanted to just catch my breath. And then all of a sudden, guess what? What do we say tonight? Wait. What do we say tonight? That when we finish tonight, Lord, let everyone have an encounter with you like Paul had to Damascus. Don't tell me God doesn't answer prayer. So one week, now how did you find out about Teen Challenge? How did you know this guy?
Some girl, her name is actually Christina. First letters of her name is Christ. She told me about this place.
Back on here just to get things right, huh? Praise the Lord. So what did you think the first couple days when you got in there?
Awesome.
Praise God. Amen. And you know what? You haven't seen anything yet. Great days are ahead. Amen. Praise God. And your name? Old, about to give his heart to Jesus. Have I seen you before? No. Okay, a couple times. I'm trying to be. Okay, I'm trying. A couple times. And again, how are you? How did you? Is this set free or just friends, family?
Friends.
You set up a couple times. So, and you've never. Okay, and your name? I'm not trying to. I'm just, you know, this is awesome, man. We're celebrating with you. Amen. And your name? Last couple weeks, man, it's been a, you know, when you have to persevere and press through, amen. I'm soaking this up before we pray, amen. So I'm sorry. I mean, you know, when you've had all day long and a couple days worth of all hell breaking loose trying to come against you, and we've gotten to a place of this is victory. So just hold. Just look at someone and say, just hold on. And your name?
Nicholas,
praise the Lord. So, Nicholas, and you're here with who?
My mom.
Okay. So we got mom over here. Praise God. Let's get mom over here. Mom. And mom is?
Mackenzie.
Okay, praise the Lord. So, have you been here before, though? Yeah. Fourth. Okay, I'm looking at face. I know they look familiar, but I don't. Not like. Okay, and you've never given, and this is the first time you're giving your heart to the Lord like this, huh? That's awesome. And how old are you?
12.
12 years old. Your name?
Will.
Praise the Lord. And how did you end up over here?
Through friends.
Okay, through friends. And how many times have you been to the church? First time here. Friends invited him. Let me ask you a question. Like, when you were so first time here and you're hearing the word go, whoa. Just a couple thoughts. Like, what was going through your mind?
Felt good.
Praise the Lord. Amen. And who do we have next to you?
Tina.
Tina, okay. And this is your girlfriend? And this is mother-in-law? Barbara? Okay, so you guys are here all year for the first time or no? God, I'm looking at your face. I'm trying to... Now, how did you guys find out about from just... Who invited you guys? Okay, so praise God. You guys first, so let me ask you a question. When you got here and you were hearing the word go forth, or let me ask you a question. The praise and worship was going on. What were you thinking?
Okay.
It felt right, huh? And that's the Holy Spirit. That's awesome. Praise God. And you guys?
Judy.
Lorenzo.
Okay, now you guys, praise the Lord.
I want to rededicate myself. Have I been away for a while?
You know he loves you, right? You know he's crazy about you, right? Look how much he loves you so much. He set this whole night up just to get you to this place tonight. Amen. Isn't that awesome? And what about you? What's going on with you? You're just here. Support. So this is your son, Lorenzo, that's here in support for mom. God bless you, young man. Praise the Lord. Amen. Make sure I'm not missing anybody. Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody else before we close? Are we good? Bible says those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Your miracle starts with a relationship with Him. You believe with all your heart and receive Him as Lord and say, God's going to forgive you tonight, wash you, and give you new strength. And in other words, new beginning. And I want to encourage some of you here tonight. Obviously, if you're here for the first time, you don't have a church home or you don't know of a church that you knew from before, I want to encourage you to be here on Saturday night. We're doing baptisms. So this is perfect timing for you to come on Saturday and put action to your faith. And I want to clarify, baptisms, water doesn't save you. Jesus saves you. The baptism is just an act of obedience. So we do it because we love him. And all that baptism means is you're just publicly decreeing and declaring what's already happened in your heart. That's all it is. So that's this Saturday. And all you got to do is just bring some clothes and a towel, get a certificate just so you can remember that night. And it's an act of obedience to follow the Lord and saying, Lord, I love you. And if this is what you want me to, and that's your start with your walk with the Lord. Amen. So I want to encourage you, Saturday at 7 o'clock. Okay, if you need Bibles, we have Bibles in the bookstore. Please make yourselves available to Bibles in the bookstore. Are you ready to pray? Lift up your hands. Just lift it. This is a sign of surrender. Just pray this prayer. Dear God, I come to you today, and I need you. I can't do this without you. I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. Jesus, I ask you to come into my life and be Lord and Savior of my life. I know I fall short of the glory, and I need you. So I surrender all to you. Wash me with your blood. Renew a right spirit within me. From this day forth, I'm all yours. Use me for your glory. I believe that you died on the cross for me. I believe, Jesus, you rose from the grave on the third day. And I believe that you are the Son of the living God. And Jesus, I believe that those who call upon your name shall be saved. I believe tonight I am forgiven as far as the east is from the west. And I'm on my way to heaven because your word says it. I believe it. And that settles it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Somebody shout hallelujah. We'll see you Saturday night. God bless every one of you.